My strength,
strength,
strength like no other,
strength like no other, reaches to me.
Peace out, my love. lift our voices and worship you, Lord. God Almighty, we worship you, Lord. We honor you, O God Almighty. We glorify your name, O God. We worship you, Father God. God Almighty, Lord of glory, oh, we worship you.
God Almighty,
God Almighty,
Lord. Always hunger for, oh,
up for your grace, Lord. Our hearts hang up for your healing, Lord God. Our hearts always hunger for our hearts hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for you. Jesus, we love you.
Your hands tonight and glorify God because our hearts are hungering for Him. If you can lift up your hands and lift your hands above where our help comes from and begin to give glory to God for all that He has done for us, even on this day 14 of prayer and fasting. We want to thank God because this day is a new day that the Lord has made. It is a day of increment. It is a day that God has purpose for you and I to see. And so you can glorify His name tonight, for He is good. He has sustained us. He has kept us under His wings, preserved us by His mercy and grace. And so we can thank Him tonight because He is good. My Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, we thank you because you are good, God. We thank you, Lord, tonight for the grace that you have, Lord, released unto us. The grace, oh Lord, my Father, that has kept us. The grace, dear God, that has surrounded us. The grace that has sustained us, Lord, even in your presence, oh God. Because without your grace, we do not deserve, Lord, even to come before your throne of grace. But God, you have sustained us, my Father, by your mercy and grace. And so, Lord, our hearts tonight desire, Lord, to dwell in your presence, because in your presence there is fullness of joy. We thank you, King of glory, because there is power in the house, oh God, tonight. And we lift, oh God, our voices to you, that you may be glorified, oh Lord. Be glorified, oh Lord. Receive all the praise and all the honor. Receive all the adoration, oh God, because there is no other God like you. You are Alpha and Omega. You are the beginning, Lord, and the end. You are the author and the finisher of our faith. In you, oh God, Lord, we put our trust. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. In Jesus' name we pray. The Bible says in Matthew chapter number 14, if you read from verse 12, you'll see when Jesus Christ was on the mountain and he had commanded his disciples to go on the other side, the Bible says that he was up there to pray. And when he went up on the mountain to pray, and there was a storm in the sea, the Bible says that when they began to see this man walking on the waters, that they were scared and they thought it was a ghost. Tonight, maybe Jesus Christ is walking towards you, towards your storm, and you are not able to see that he is walking towards you. I want us to lift up our hands tonight and pray that he may open our eyes, that we may see him as our Lord and Savior, even in the storm. Because he is walking towards you. But the Bible says when Peter and the other disciples saw this person walking on the waters when the storm was pushing their vessel. I don't know what kind of storm that is pushing your vessel tonight. Maybe it is a storm in your career. Maybe a storm in your family. Maybe a storm in your business. But I want to assure us that Jesus Christ is up there, because on the mountain is a vantage place to see what is down there. And he saw that his people were going through a storm, were faced by a storm. Yes, we've been faced by storms this year, but whatever storm it is, I want you to cast it to the Lord, because he is walking towards you to speak to your storm. So lift up your hands and begin to thank God, because he is coming towards you. He is walking towards you. You may be scared and wondering, what is this I'm seeing? Is it a ghost? Is it a spirit? But it is Jesus himself coming to speak to that storm in your life. He is able. He is able to calm the storm. Begin to thank him in your own words. Father, we thank you because, God, you are the God of Lord. Even in the storm, you are able, Lord, to calm the storm, Jehovah God, by only three words. When you spoke to the storm and said, peace be still. Tonight, oh God, in the name of Jesus Christ, by faith we speak to that storm in that family, that storm in that marriage about to cause divorce, that storm in that career, that storm in that school. We speak to that storm, peace be still in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. That storm of sickness and disease, that storm of ill health, we are speaking to you, storm, be cast out, because the Lord is on the throne, because the Lord is speaking to you. Peace be still. Peace be still. Every storm, peace be still. The storm of financial challenges, peace be still. The storm of sickness, peace be still. The storm of discouragement, peace be still. In Jesus' name we pray. This week, by the leading of the Holy Spirit, we have been praying and looking at being fruitful, because God is increasing us. If you focus on the Lord, if you put your eyes on the Lord, you'll be able to see what God is doing. God has not brought anything around us to cause fear, but God is opening our inner eyes that we may see how fruitful we can become in the middle of the storm. How fruitful we can become in the middle of the storm. And Psalms 139, verse number 17. Psalms 139, verse 17. God wants us to be fruitful. He told Adam and Eve in Genesis 1:28 that, go ye therefore and multiply and fill and subdue the earth. God wants us to be fruitful. That is what he told Adam and Eve in Genesis 1:28. But in Psalms 139, the Bible says, verse 17, 139 verse 17, how precious also are your thoughts to me. God's thoughts towards you are precious. How precious also are thy thoughts unto me. If you believe that God's thoughts towards you are precious, begin to thank him and say, Father, I thank you because you have precious thoughts unto me. You have great thoughts unto me. God has great thoughts unto you. Thoughts to increase you. Thoughts to multiply you. When they say, you know, stop because the world is coming to an end, you can lift your voice and say, Father, I thank you that even if the world is coming to the end, I know that I have hope in you because you have great thoughts over my life. Because I'm walking in faith and not by the things that I see. I'm walking in the word. I'm not walking by my own understanding, but I'm walking guided divinely by your thoughts. I thank you, everlasting Father, because how precious indeed, Lord, are your thoughts towards us. And the Bible says, oh God, how great is the sum of them. How great is the sum of them. It is not just one thought, but there are thoughts, the sum. Sum means it is, you know, there are many, many thoughts that God has unto us. God has many thoughts about you, not just one thought. When you have been blessed by one thing, you think that is it. No, God says that was just one of the sum. It is just one of the many thoughts I had towards you. Thank God, begin to thank God, because there are still so many thoughts which God has over your life that you have not seen. He said, the things which he has in store for you, your eyes have not yet seen, your ears have not yet heard, nor has your mind perceived what God has in store for you. So if you have one door open, don't just stop there, because doors will begin to open. The doors will begin to open, because he says that these are many thoughts. It is a sum of thoughts, not just one thought, many thoughts that God has over our lives. And God, we thank you because there are many thoughts which you have over our lives. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. And the Bible says in verse 18, if I should count them, if you can begin to count the many thoughts that God has over your life, the many thoughts that God has over your life, Psalms 139, 18, if I should count, they will be more in number than the sand. There will be more in number than the sand. The thoughts which God has over your life, the thoughts which he has over my life, they are more in number than the sand. If you know and believe that God has many thoughts over your life, begin to thank him because he has been good. How much has he done for you? How many doors has God opened for you that you can't even remember? The only thing you are seeing is the trouble that is ahead of you. The only thing that is scaring you is what you're going through right now. But he says, I have so many thoughts. I have so many plans, as he tells Jeremiah. I have so many ideas over your life. I have so many good things in mind over you. I think about you every moment. I think about you day and night, because even when you are going through the night, he is able to bring the light in the morning. He says, the Bible says in Psalms 30 and verse 5, that yes, morning weeping may endure for the night, but joy comes in the morning. Before every light, before the daybreak, there must be dark, the dark hour. There must be darkness. Daybreak comes after the darkest hour of the night. At four in the morning, you see it gets too dark. And then by five thereabout, it begins, the light, the daybreak begins to come in. Yes, you may have gone through the dark moments this year, but I want to assure us, brethren, that our God is causing the daybreak to come our ways. Lift up your hands and begin to pray. Thank God, because the daybreak is coming. The daybreak is at hand. The daybreak has come. The night is over, and the daybreak has come. It is time for us to arise and shine. It is time for you to arise and shine, for the glory of God has risen upon you. Arise and shine. Father, we thank you. We bless your name because, God, the daybreak is here. We've been through the night since February, when there was this scare and this rumor of death and the spirit of death that was hovering in the air. The night that people have gone through this year, we thank you because, God, daybreak has come and the night is finally over. We will not, Lord, listen to the voice of the world, the voice of the scaremongers, and the voice of the pandemic, but we shall turn to the Lord our God and listen to your voice, because, God, you say that I have commanded thee, Ezekiel, live, thou shalt not die, but live. And tonight, oh God, we thank you because your people shall live and they shall be multiplied. They shall be increased in number in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. My God, we thank you because your word, my Father, is true. Your promises are yeah and amen, and you are faithful in every way. Lord God, even as we continue to pray in this month of October, as we continue to wait upon you, Jehovah God, we know one thing for sure, that thou shalt multiply your people, as your word says in Hebrews 16, that you shall multiply your people, oh God. You will not, Jehovah God, Lord, decrease them, but you shall increase them, my Father. And Lord God, we thank you tonight, because in Jeremiah 30:19, you say that we shall not be shamed, but we shall be glorified. As we wait upon you this month of October, we know for sure our God is faithful, and he is going to surround his people with glory, with a fresh anointing, with a new beginning, that the night shall come to an end, and as children of destiny, that we, oh God, are being lifted to the next level of glory by faith. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. And so, Father God, we thank you. We bless your name because, God, how wonderful it is to be in your presence. How glorious it is to dwell, even, Lord, at the mercy seat, O God. How glorious it is, Father, to assemble, Lord, in thy sanctuary and call upon your name. We pray tonight, Father, for all those who are connected to this service, that, Lord, they will receive exactly what you have purposed, Lord, to bless them with today in the name of Jesus. For we live not by sight, but by faith. Because without faith, it is impossible to please you. So says your word in Hebrews 11 and 6. We come to you, Lord, by faith. Lord, believing in what we do not see, because your word says, how can hope be seen? Hope is not seen, but it assures us that there's something that God you have in store for your children. Through this moment, O God of darkness, from the beginning of the year, Lord, you've been faithful, you've been merciful, you've been gracious, and we proclaim that, Lord, by your word, we shall live. By your word, we shall endure. By your word, we shall stand. By your word, we shall overcome, O God. Receive all the honor and all the glory, my Father. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. Amen, amen, amen. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Amen. Amen, amen, amen. Let's be seated in Jesus' name. Are we blessed to be in God's house? Let's take our seats in Jesus' name. If you have a neighbor a meter away or 6 miles away or 10 miles away, just smile at your neighbor. Amen. I was sharing with somebody this evening, even as you prepare to bring your praise report, I was sharing with somebody this evening who was very discouraged. And he's in old age. And he was telling me that, you know, I'm looking around and I see no hope. There is no hope in this life. And this is not a poor man. This is a rich man, a wealthy man. But he was telling me, I see no hope. Everything is dull. Everything has come to a standstill. And I shared with him a scripture in 2 Kings chapter 14. And 2 Kings 7. 2 Kings 7. Verse 4, when the lepers were sitting by the gate and they said, you know, sitting here won't help us. We need food. We need support. We need provisions. But let's go to the Arameans. If they don't, you know, if they don't spare us, then we die. If they kill us, so be it. But if we still here, if we still sit here, we're going to die anyway. So I was telling him that there is hope in God. Just wake up in the morning, get into that shower, freshen up and step out and begin to step into your destiny. Amen. And he told me that is a very simple instruction. Just wake up in the morning, get into the shower and step out. It's a very simple instruction, but it has really encouraged me. And so, brethren, in God, there is hope. Amen? In God, there is hope. If you have your praise report, this is the moment. This is our 14th day of prayer, and we shall continue to pray because it is our prayer month. Amen? Amen. You have a praise report? Praise report. Amen. Brother Albert, you're welcome. You're welcome. I'll give you one of the microphones. Amen. Please share with us what God has done to encourage us, so that we can rejoice with you even as we continue to pray for one another. Amen.
I've been praying a lot, you know, just, you know, fasting, praying, you know, as I usually do. Those of us that are here, we understand how God works when we endure. Endurance is an important part of our Christian walk. Standing still is an important part of our walk. When he says stand still, he means stand still. Anyway, I just wanted to share what happened to me the other day. I was at work, and the Lord came upon me like he hasn't came upon me in a while. You know, I broke down, but it was an answered prayer. But it felt like, those of you that know, when you're saved, you know, you go through this emotional, and you get over it, and then you're living your life, and then you wonder why, you know, where's God? How come I don't feel that feeling no more, you know? But later on, as you endure, the Lord hits you again with his mercy and his grace and his love and his understanding and the comfort that we all need. And when the Lord did this to me, it was just a reminder of, you know, I'm still there. Even though you are going through what you're going through. Yeah. I mean, I've never been through a trial. I've been through so many trials, but not like the one that I'm going through. But, you know, the endurance also comes from God, because as the scripture said, when I awake, I'm still with you. And that's the way I felt. I felt like awakening out of this, you know, ugly trial that I've, you know, and I feel like, wow, I'm still here. And you have to thank God, because you're here because he allowed you to be here. And once again, he's teaching you, I'm upholding you. Those are not your footprints, they're mine. And that's what we're looking at. We all, as Christians, we want God to like appear in our hearts once again, because you know the feeling of God when he comes into your heart and your soul. So we're all like, at times we're like, where is he at? And then when he hits you, it's like he saves you all over again. And it was a big experience for me. Everything in my life is big. Everything. And I want to just give all the glory and thanks. And the endurance was, I think, the most important part of this awakening. Is the Lord was telling me, endure. Endure to the end. And I think it's important for all of us to, when we read that scripture, when he says that we must endure, we must, because he is the one that is upholding us. Even when we think that we're doing it, we're not. We're not doing nothing. We need him for every single thing, everything. And until we learn that, we're going to continue to go, you know, have harder times. But once we know that God is there no matter what, I mean, at times we're going to feel that he's not, but he's there. Especially if you know you're saved. And I just thank God for giving me that experience again. And letting me feel his love and that comfort and that, you know, that spirit that just, you know. And those that are saved know what I'm talking about. You know God is there with you. When you also know that 99.99% of the people have already walked away.
Amen.
And that's when the Lord shows up.
Mm.
He says, they've all walked away. But I'm still here. Thank you, Jesus.
Amen. 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 Let's put our hands together. And I appreciate the Lord. Thank you, Jesus, for the encouragement, word of encouragement from our brother Albert. If you're saying that what you're going through now, you've never been through, you know, God was asking me, ask him, how about the life sentence? That is the most difficult thing you can ever imagine. But if God saw you through the life sentence, you know, I felt in my spirit to just tell you that you need to be live on Covenant TV and share your testimony there. And let people know that life sentence is not the final verdict. God's, and that's what I heard in my spirit to just tell you. You have to be on Covenant TV and begin to share your testimonies and reach out to many. Amen, in Jesus' name. Amen. Father, we thank you. Let's just be upstanding, begin to thank God as I invite our senior pastor. You know, let's arise and begin to thank God. Father, we thank you, Lord. We thank you. We thank you. There is none like you, King of glory. You alone are God. Thank you for this moment, Lord. Take over, Holy Spirit of God. Take over, Holy Spirit of God. You are welcome, Holy Spirit of God. Thank you, Jesus.
We bow down and worship Yahweh. We bow down and worship Yahweh. Thank you. We bow down before you this evening and we say, Hallowed be your name. Thank you, Lord, for bringing us again to your presence. Thank you, Lord, for you are faithful in all you do. Blessed be your name, Lord. There is none like you. We give you praise. We give you all the glory. For in Jesus, and to be equipped such that we all will fulfill our destiny. Like we've been told, you and I, we are children of destiny. And no matter what you're going through right now, I want you to know that there is a place you are going to. And that place is a place of glory. In Romans chapter 8, verse 28, it says, all things work together for good. Somebody say all things. Somebody say all things. Even when you are going through challenges, all things. When you are facing storms, all things. When things appear to be going upside down, all things. For them that love God, and to them that are called. If you are a child of God, you have a calling of God upon your life. God himself called you. And in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 24, it says, faithful is he that has called you, who will also do it. Somebody shout hallelujah. Faithful is he that has called you, who will also give you the breakthrough, who will also give you the success, who will also give you the victory. God will never give you a vision without giving you the provision. He will never give you a commission without giving you the provision to fulfill that calling. You might go through storms, might go through challenges, but in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 3, it says, endure hardness as a soldier. Somebody shout hallelujah. Endure hardness as a soldier of Christ, because your present affliction is but for a moment. It is a light affliction. It is but for a moment, and it shall work for you a greater weight of glory, and it will give you a place in eternity. If you fail not, if you refuse not to be deterred, endurance, knowing fully well that he that has called you is faithful. He that has promised is not a man that will lie. He that has called you is able to take you to that place he has promised. I want to encourage you tonight that you are still alive today is because there's a destiny of God in your life. And no pandemic can cut you short. There's still a purpose in your future that nothing will stop you if you refuse to stop yourself. And one of the ways in which you can ensure that you don't stop yourself is by ensuring that you get connected daily at every opportunity to his word, because it is the word of God that giveth light and giveth understanding even unto the simple, unto the humble, unto those that humble themselves under the mighty word of God. So tonight the Lord is set to release his word again. And in his word, there's light. And that light shows you the way out of every situation. In his word, there is instruction. In his word, there is guidance. As you receive that word tonight, I pray that every issue of confusion, every issue of limitation, everything that is causing storms around you, there will be calm, there will be clarity, there will be direction coming your way in the name of Jesus. So I'd like you to just join me as I invite Pastor Sophie to come and bring that word to us tonight. And I know that the Lord is said to speak again. And I'm here to listen and to hearken diligently. And I know as you do so, the Lord will equip you for victory in the name of Jesus. God bless you, woman of God. You're welcome.
I'm so grateful this evening. I want to appreciate the Father of the house for this opportunity that he has given unto me that we may share together the word of God. And before we do that, let's pray. Everlasting Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, we thank you. We worship you, Most High God, and we give you glory and honor, Father. We thank you for your word, O God, which is our daily bread. Father, we thank you because, Lord God, of the word that creates life in us, and the word that sanctifies us, O God, and the word that makes us better people, O Lord God, in the name of Jesus Christ. Father, we thank you for the word that changes our world, O God. The word that changes our perception to things, O Lord God. And we thank you, Father, for your word that gives us life. Lord, tonight as you speak to us, Father God, we open our ears, Lord God. And we open the ears of our hearts, Lord God, the ears of our understanding. And that the eyes of our understanding will be enlightened by your power in the name of Jesus Christ. Holy Spirit, we need you. Minister to us the revelation of the word of God this evening. Lord, I pray that you may speak through me. I just present myself before you as a vessel. Lord, just to bring out what you are speaking through my mouth, O God. Amen. And Father, I pray that at the end of it all, God, I will give you all the glory. Take all the glory in advance, Lord, for you deserve it, oh God. In Jesus' mighty name I pray. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God bless you so much for coming into the presence of God. It's been a refreshing moment to seek the face of God and just to be found in that precious presence of God. And just to experience that goodness of God in his presence. Amen. And I thank God for the victory that he is bringing our way even this month. The victory is great. The victory is more than a testimony. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. And so this evening, I thank God for his word. And the word that the Lord has given unto us is that it's talking about the right mind. The right mind. You know, we believe that we are the children of God. Because we have made the children of God by Jesus Christ, by believing in Jesus Christ, we are become the children of God. And this comes by us believing in our hearts and in our mind, making it to sink into our mind that we are the children of God. Hallelujah. You know, talking about the theme of our this year's conference about breaking limits, you know, the mind, the limitations begins from the mind. And breaking the limitations too, breaking the limits begins from our mind too. And it will not just happen in the ordinary mind. It will happen in the right mind. Praise the Lord. So let us read the book of Romans chapter 12 and verse 2. Romans chapter 12, verse 2. Romans chapter 12, verse 2. Sorry. What does it say? About renewing our mind. Romans Amen. It says,
do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect.
Amen. But do not be conformed to the world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. That you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Praise the Lord. And so what is the mind? The definition, I found out that the definition of mind is that the mind is the set of faculties, including cognitive aspects such as, one, consciousness, two, imagination, three, perception, four, thinking, five, intelligence, six, judgment, seven, language and memory, as well as non-cognitive aspects such as emotions and instinct. Those are the faculties of the mind. Consciousness, imagination, perception, thinking, intelligence and judgment, and language and memory. So the right mind has to consist of consciousness. The right mind has to consist of imagination. You have to have that ability to imagine. The ability to imagine something. And to have the ability to perceive. The ability to think. If you have the mind and you don't think, you want people to think for you, you're not making use of your mind. It must have the ability of intelligence. Intelligence. And it must have the ability of judgment, to judge between the right and the wrong. The mind. And it must have the language. The mind has a language. And the mind has a memory. It has a memory. What you imagine must be kept in memory so that when you want to implement it, you'll know what you imagined. And when you imagined it, you created it. And now you bring it into existence. Praise the Lord. And so the mind power is one of the strongest and most useful power we possess. Is one of the strongest and most useful power we possess. And this power, together with your imagination, can create. The power of the mind, together with the imagination, now creates, and it can create one, success or failure. Two, it can create happiness or unhappiness. Three, it can create opportunity or obstacles. And the mind power is composed of your attention. The mind power has to be pushed by your attention. You have to attend to it. And your mental images and your thoughts. knowing that your thoughts are your energy. Your mental image and your thoughts. So the mind power is composed of your attention, your mental images, and your thoughts. Praise the Lord. So we want to just understand what the mind is, so that when we talk about the mind, we'll know what we're talking about and its power. So that we'll not be out of our mind. You know, there are people who are living and they are out of their mind. Very dangerous. Very dangerous in life. You are living and you are out of your mind. May God help us. The mind is very powerful. It is unlimited in potential. It's very powerful that it cannot be limited in potential. It has a very big potential that cannot be limited. And we can create anything we desire just by letting the mind do what it was created by God to do. We can create anything. Anything. Anything that we can imagine, we can create. If we'll just let the mind do what it was created by God to do. Praise the Lord. And let us know that life has a purpose for us. And it will give us abundance if we programmed our mind in that direction. If we program our mind in the direction of the purpose that the life has in store for us, it will give us abundance. Praise the Lord. And so we have to direct our mind towards the purpose that the life has in store for us, that God has in store for us. So when we direct our mind to that purpose, then we walk in the abundance of the provision of that purpose that God has purpose for us and the life that has to give unto us in Jesus' name. And God has given to every person on this planet the same capacity in their brain. But not everyone uses it. The brain that God gave unto you is the same capacity that God gave unto every one of us. But the difference is, some use their brain 90% and others use their brain just 10%. So if you use your brain at 10%, don't blame God while someone else is using his brain or her brain 90%. Don't blame God that God gave you small brain and gave the other one big brain. It is the capacity, it's the ability. It's the ability to make you, to put your mind at work. When you put your mind at work, when you send your mind on errands, let your mind work and bring the results into the physical. If you refuse to think, if you refuse to be innovative, if you refuse to be creative, don't envy that person who does not sleep because his mind is working 24/7. And most people who don't put their mind at work, they are the people who envy others and talk evil about those people who succeed. Because their minds are dormant. Their minds don't have work to do. They've not been given any work to do. So their minds are idle. And so the mind has to work. You have you know, you cannot overwork your mind because it has that power and potential. You can, it's only your body that can break down, but your mind cannot break down. Because God has given that mind that biggest potential to handle everything, every imagination that you want to create. Everything that you want to create in this life, God has given the mind the ability and the capacity to handle it. Praise the Lord. And so, one person said that if we just take a couple of people, a couple of people's brain, and put them together, these brains, the power in this brain, is able to light the city for a period of 1 week. Just the brains. And you can see now the power that is in your mind. If they take just a couple of people and put them together, the brain together, it can light, the brain can light a city for a period of 1 week. Our mind is powerful. Our mind is powerful. Our mind is limited by the choices we make and the beliefs we were programmed with. It is powerful, but it can be limited by the choices we make, by our beliefs, and how we program it. And this is what is affecting mankind. The choice that you make, the belief that you believe in, the programming that you have programmed your mind. And as you program your mind, the mind will just be, will follow that program. That's what we call the mindset. The way you set your mind, that is how your mind will function. But the choice that you make in life, the choice that you make in life will determine the result that you'll get. In the name of Jesus, we pray that our choice will be the right choice. That our choice will expand our territories in the name of Jesus Christ by the use of our mind in Jesus' name. And how our mind is programmed or set from the time we were born will determine our life either positively or negatively. And whatever your mind can conceive and believe, it can be achieved. Whatever your mind can conceive and you believe, it can be achieved. And so when I put together the mind and the faith, you can do great things. You can cause explosions. When you put together the right mind and the faith that works, you can cause exploits. Praise the Lord. It just takes the right mind. It just takes the right mind to cause exploits around us. And you know, we can reprogram. The good news is that our minds can be reprogrammed. And how do we reprogram it? We can reprogram or set. We can reprogram our minds by the transformation that renews our mind. So, our minds can be reprogrammed by its renewal. Praise the Lord. So it's transformed. When you reprogram it, it means you are transforming from the former programming, and now you are transforming to a new programming. that will give you the right results. Praise the Lord. And so our mind can take us to any heights, any depths, and any width, based on how you have set your mind, based on how you have programmed your mind. And you know, I'm just talking about the normal mind. But how about those who know God? How about those who know Christ? How about those who are in Christ Jesus? Let's read 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 13 through 16.
The Bible says, and we impart this in words not taught. Chapter 2?
Yes, chapter 2.
Verse 13.
Verse 13, yes.
And we impart this in words not taught by human wisdom, but taught by the Spirit, interpreting spiritual truths to those who are spiritual. The natural person does not accept the things of the Spirit of God, for they are folly to him, or foolishness to him, and he is not able to understand them because they are spiritually discerned. That's verse 14. The spiritual person judges all things, but is himself to be judged by no one. For who has understood the mind of the Lord so as to instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ.
Amen.
We have the mind of Christ. No one has understood the mind of the Lord to instruct him. But we have the mind of Christ. The mind of Christ that perceives all things. The mind of God that supersedes all the minds, the normal minds. So the mind of Christ, because we have Christ in us and we bear the mind of Christ in us, we are more, we should do more great things than those people who are operating in the normal mind. But it's unfortunate that those people who have the mind of Christ, who know Christ, do so little, while the people who are just operating on the human mind are doing great things. Are bringing great things into existence. But the people who know Christ are just confessing faith. They just talk about, by faith I'll do this. By faith this I possess this. By faith this one will be mine. You don't know that before you came to possess by faith this building that you are possessing, someone, somewhere, imagined this building. He put his mind at work. He imagined of building this building. And imagined and he worked on it and brought it into being. And he invested in it. So when you see it standing there, then you go possess it by faith. Praise the Lord. It's not bad to have faith. But even Jesus said the faith without actions is dead. Faith, you have faith, but you have to make your mind work together with faith. Faith is the evidence of things hoped for. Faith brings things hoped of, things that cannot be seen into being. But you will have to, you will have to use your mind to include your mind together with your faith. The people who are just live by faith and not doing anything or adding anything on that faith. And they have been proclaiming that faith until now. And they end up now saying, I don't have to have faith again in God because God failed me. I trusted in him. I had faith in him. I had faith that God gives me that job, but God didn't give me the job. I had faith that God will give me money to build a building or to buy a building, but God did not give. Did you make any step? Did you put anything in your mind by faith or on top of that faith, and you took a step that could make the faith work? Praise the Lord. So God now in this First Corinthians, God is taking us into another dimension of the mind. That God has said for those born of him, which is the realm of the spirit. The realm, the dimension of the mind of the spirit. And so, for those who are born of the spirit, that's what the Bible says, they are the spirit and they overcome the world. Those who are born by the spirit, they are the spirit and they overcome the world. And so, we overcome. Our victory must begin from the mind. Our conquering must begin from the mind. You have to draw your strategies through your mind. Even those people, those people who are involved in battles, they know before they go to the battlefield, they go on the drawing board. They use their mind. They put their minds in action. And they scheme and they plan. So when they go to the battlefield, they go putting everything that they have learned in their mind, and then they execute the operation and they overcome the world. Praise the Lord. And so the right mind will give us victory. The right mind will make us to overcome. Will cause us to overcome the world. Praise the Lord. And so, let us read Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 21. Ephesians 4, 21. I like this First Corinthians when they say the carnal mind cannot perceive the things of the spirit. But we have the mind of Christ. So we have that ability to perceive. We have that ability to discern the things of the spirit because of the mind of Christ that is in us. Ephesians chapter 4 verse 21.
Assuming that you have heard about him and were taught in him, as the truth is in Jesus, to put off your old self. One. Assuming that you have heard about him and were taught in him, as the truth is in Jesus.
Okay, go to 23.
And to be renewed in the spirit. Let me just read that. Okay, let me continue. To put off your old self, which belongs to your former manner of life and is corrupt through deceitful desires, and to be renewed in the spirit of your minds.
Amen.
And to put on the new self, created after the likeness of God in true righteousness and holiness.
Amen. So we do not just have that normal mind. We have the mind that contains the spirit in it. that you should be renewed in the spirit of your mind. So it's not just the mind that has the living spirit in it. And so when the mind has the living spirit in it, it can discern what is in the spirit. It can create what is in the spirit and bring it into the physical. It can take what is, the Bible says, the spirit searches the mind of God. That spirit can take what is in the mind of God and reveal it unto you, and you speak it into existence. Praise the Lord. So the renewal of our spirit, the spirit of our mind. In Romans, we talked about being transformed by the renewal of our mind. But in the spiritual dimension, we're talking about the renewal of the spirit of your mind. The renewal of the spirit. In everything that is, in everything that exists, there is a spirit behind it. Even in failure, there is a spirit of failure behind it. In success, there is a spirit of success behind it. And so for you to be transformed, totally be transformed, first the spirit has to be transformed. So that spirit, when that spirit is transformed, then the mind is transformed. Even having faith, you must have the spirit of faith. Because without the spirit of faith, your faith will endure for a short time. But when you have that spirit of faith, this spirit will push your faith. This spirit will push your faith until it achieves what you believe in. So the renewal of the spirit of your mind, in being in the dimension of the renewal of the spirit of your mind, not just the mind. Because you see people say, I've transformed, I'm not going to do it again. Tomorrow they do it. Because the spirit has not been renewed. The spirit that gives life to that decision has not been renewed. It's still the same spirit. And Paul says in Ephesians that we have to take off that old man and put on the new man. That old spirit has to die and the new spirit in us be renewed, so that we can walk in the newness of the dimension that we want to walk in. When the spirit, when the old man of our mind has been put off, and the spirit of the new man, you know, when we talk about putting on the new man, we are not talking about the physical putting on. We talk about Jesus Christ, and this we believe it in our spirit. And we become the children of God by the Spirit. And so when we are putting off the old man and we are putting on the new man, it is happening in our spirits. And when it happens in our spirits, it affects our physical. Praise the Lord. And it has to start from the spirit. Change, you don't see change when you just transform your mind without it being happening in the spirit. So it has to start, begin from the spirit and manifest in the physical. So having the mind of Christ takes us into the spirit. It takes us into the spirit world. Takes us into the realm of the spirit and bring forth the things that we could not access just in the normal mind. Praise the Lord. So the mind of Christ goes beyond the grave. The mind of Christ goes beyond the travail. The mind of Christ goes beyond persecution. He says, even when you are persecuted, no, be joyful because your reward is great. So you don't give up because of what you are seeing now, because that mind of Christ takes you beyond, takes your vision beyond what you are seeing now. You don't die giving up in the persecutions, on the test, but see beyond the persecution. See beyond the test that you're going through, because great is the reward. Praise the Lord. And then 2 Timothy, 2 Timothy chapter 1 verse 7. 2 Timothy chapter 1 verse 7.
The Bible says, "For God gave us a spirit not of fear, but of power and love and self-control or sound mind."
Amen. Amen. God did not give us the spirit of fear, because we have the mind of Christ. We don't operate in the spirit of fear. But He has given us the spirit of love, the spirit of power, and the spirit of a sound mind. The spirit of power to dominate, power to take control, power to overcome, power to overthrow, power to build, power to bring down. Amen. Praise the Lord. So He says it is a spirit of the sound mind. The spirit of a sound mind. So when we walk in the sound mind, it enables us to create things in the spiritual and call them forth into the physical. The sound mind. A drunkard person will declare something while he's drunkard, while he's drunk. When he's sober, you say, "I didn't say it." And this is what believers do. They declare something that this year, this is my declaration. And they declare and sit down. And when the year ends, they say, "No, I was just joking. I didn't mean it. I didn't mean it. I didn't mean that I'm supposed to have built a house by the end of the year." So we behave like drunkards. Because you did not do it with a sound mind. The Bible says you shall declare a thing and it shall be established. Hallelujah. This declaration will only be made with a person of a sound mind, who will declare it and make sure that it is established. And so we call forth things from the spiritual into the physical. And all things we see started in the mind. Someone had a thought of something. Someone perceived something. Someone went into thinking. And He gave judgment to the thinking and He decided to do something. All these technologies we are enjoying, someone used his mind and brought things from the imagination into operation. Praise the Lord. And so we, as the people of God who are full of the Spirit of God, we have to do more than that. The spirit that was with God during creation. You know what happened when God was creating? God saw things in the spirit. And God created them in His mind. And then He spoke them forth. He saw them. He created them and then he spoke them forth. That's when he told Jeremiah, I knew you. Before you were put in your mother's womb. Before you existed, I knew you because I had you in my mind. I thought of someone like you. And I created you in my mind. Then I brought you forth and put you in your mother's womb. So don't challenge me in anything. Because I had that sketch of you. Before you knew about yourself. So it has to start by thinking. It has to, be, to get to the point of creating and speaking it forth, bringing it into existence. And that's what we speak by faith. When we speak things by faith, we believe what we have created in our mind, and we believe in the power of the one who is able to make them come to pass. And we believe as we speak them by faith, and we believe that we can do all things through him, Christ, who strengthens us. Through the mind, the Christ mind that is within us, we can do all things. We can create all things. We can bring into being all things in the name of Jesus Christ. And so, when God imagined and he created and he spoke forth, everything that he spoke forth, when it came into being, he saw and he said, it is good. Why? Because he did it with a sound mind. The sound mind is a mind of perfection. The sound mind, you know, when you operate with a sound mind, you will do perfect things. You will work things out in intelligence. When you work with a sound, when you have the sound mind, you will walk in wisdom. And the mind of Christ in us, and the spirit that God has given unto us, which is the spirit of the sound mind, that is at work within us, that we walk, we renew our minds, we transform, we are transformed from what we see to broadening our visions. Broadening how we see is not, we see beyond what the world can see. And we bring them from what the world cannot see and bring them into the world. And God has given unto us that ability. But we have limited our ability. We have limited the potential that we have. And the many limitations that we have is because people spoke things in our minds and they programmed our minds. And when our minds were programmed in that way, we feel that that is who we are. That is who we are made to be. We are talking about deliverance. Talk about, I cannot, I will not. I can't because this is what I believe. This is what they told me. When we were growing up, some of us, our teachers spoke things in our lives that really made other people to leave school and go just stay home because the teacher told them, you are not going anywhere. They say, just warm the seats, but you're not going anywhere. So it sunk into their minds. And say, why should I be waking up every morning going to school and I'm going nowhere? Because the teacher has spoken. My teacher once said, he told me, you know, you've forgotten that you are an orphan. And it will take some of us to contribute for your school fees so that you can join the high school. And I went home and I thought about it. And I prayed, I told God, never allow, even if it will be about contributing my school fees, never allow this teacher to contribute his money. And I said, no one will contribute towards my school fees. And I will go to school and I will complete my high school. And this teacher who was saying this was my Sunday school teacher at church. You can imagine if I took it that way. What we have received, what we have programmed in our mind is ruling over us. It has ruled over us. But we have to take it out. We have to remove all these limitations. Because when we were created, those things were not there. They were just impacted on us when we were growing up. When God created us, He did not create any failure. When God created us, He did not create any fool. Only because we were told we are fools. I refuse to be a fool in the name of Jesus Christ. I refuse to be what people call me in the name of Jesus Christ. I renew my mind. I transform my mind by believing what God says I am. And I know that I'm a child of God. And I'm not going to be limited by anything. Because my God has blessed me. He has given me everything that I need that pertains this life. Praise the Lord. So let us stand up on our feet even as I walk out the pastor to pray for us. And just lift your hands unto the Lord. And tell God, create in me a sound mind. Create in me the right mind, Lord. Let my mind be transformed into the right mind. That the mind of Christ may be formed in me. The mind of Christ may be formed in me. And that the spirits of the sound mind may be at work within me in Jesus' name. Lord, we pray that God, our mind, we will not operate on the normal mind, oh Lord God. But Lord, we will operate in the supernatural mind. The mind that is being, that operates in the spirit in the name of Jesus Christ. I refuse to be limited by what people say I am. By how people see me. Because my mind has potential. My mind has power to create things. My mind has power to take me far. My mind has power to take, it has eyes to see me in far nations in the name of Jesus Christ. I'm not going to limit myself by where I am. I'm sending my mind into errands. I'm sending my mind to go and sojourn the lands. I'm sending my mind to go and bring forth what God intended for my life in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Within me, create in me a clear heart, O Lord, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence, O Lord. Take not thy Holy Spirit from me, Lord. Restore unto me the joy of my salvation. Spirit within me, cast me not away, cast me not away from your presence, O Lord. Take not your Holy Spirit to me. The joy of our salvation. I renew our right spirit within me. I renew our right spirit within me.
Hallelujah. The mind. How powerful is the mind? Our mind is so powerful. From what I've heard tonight, is the seat of my thoughts, my perception, my imagination, my decisions, is the seat of language, is the seat of my discernment. So everything that pertains to life emanates from the power of the mind. No wonder the Bible says, guard your heart, which is also in many translations means the mind, with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. Guard it. Guard it. Because out of it are the issues of life. The one man that made it and the other that did not make any impact, it's determined by the use of the mind. The one person that is a billionaire today and the other person that is a pauper today is all determined by how effectively we use our mind. God gave us the same platform. We all have the same mind. But he also told us, like we read, that we should renew our mind. We should renew our mind. Your mind, the way it is, cannot take you to where God has for you. He said, be not conformed to this world. Why? Because our mind is already indoctrinated with traditions, customs, and ideas of this world. He said, we should renew our mind. We should renew our mind. Because many people have limited themselves, limited their destiny, because they have a myopic mind. They think so little of themselves. They think they are always seeing the problems. They will never see a solution. They refuse to meditate and to paint a beautiful picture of their future. They refuse to sit and to evaluate their life and imagine it to see how they want their life to be. And many just are satisfied with the status quo. Ephesians 3:20 says, according to the power that worketh in us. He said this, what is able to do what? Exceedingly, abundantly, above all that we can ask or imagine. The power of your imagination is what determines the power, what God can do. Start start painting a picture and see God perform. Paint a picture from the word of the scriptures. What is God saying about your life? Begin to get visions, insights, and imaginations. Don't limit your mind. Don't limit the scope of God. Many people are limiting God. God says he's able to do exceedingly. He's able to do abundantly. He's above that you can even ask or imagine. Before you ask, you need to imagine it. Before you speak it forth, you must have imagined it. That is why faith is empty without imagination. Your faith is empty just saying it without having imagined it is empty faith. I want you to lift up your hands and just pray to the Lord. Lord, I receive the power of creative imagination. Lord, grant unto me by the power of the Spirit of God that dwelleth in me. Lord, I want to create a future, a glorious future. Lord, I create a destiny of glory in the name of Jesus. Where imagination stops, that is where destiny ends. You remember the woman that called unto Elijah in 1 Kings chapter 4 and said, the creditors wants to take my children. And Elijah said, what do you have in the house? And he said, I have but a cruse of oil. And by the power of imagination, he said, as long as there was vessel in the house, the oil was flowing. As long that there was vessel, immediately there was no vessel, the cruse of oil stopped. God does not have problem giving you whatever you need. But you must have the power of imagination to be able to hold it. Where that imagination stops, there God stops. I want you to pray, Lord, grant me the grace to paint a picture of glory, of financial breakthrough, of health, of joy, peace, of a family life that is worthy of you, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Paint a picture and you see, and you put God into action. Thank you, everlasting Father, that your daughter, that your son, the Lord says, begin to see, paint a picture. What do you desire? What is your desire? Then begin to see it come to pass. The power of the mind. Father, Lord, we thank you. Father, Lord, we give you praise. Thank you for your word tonight. By the power of our mind, we are breaking every limitation. We are breaking every limitation. Every I can't syndrome, we are breaking that in the name of Jesus. Every seat of excuse that is limiting us, we're breaking it in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. We give you all the praise. For in Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. Amen. Hallelujah. Let's put our hands together unto the Lord.
Hallelujah. We give you praise, oh God. We bless your name. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. It can't be better than that. Amen. Amen. There's something that God is doing, and I bless the name of the Lord for that. Hallelujah. We thank God for the word. That is the word that we received from our Father, and now it is coming to us, and it will keep flowing. Amen. You know, the word has challenged me. I thought I am a thinker. I realize I'm not even there. I'm not even started. Amen. When the word was coming, I was like, oh, I thought I'm a think tank. I always thought I am one. But when I got the revelation tonight, I'm challenged. And I've drawn the picture already in my mind. And I see where I want to go now, even clearer. Amen. And I believe if we, you know, the word will only work for you if you believe in it. If you don't believe in it, it's okay. It will not work for you. But I believe this word is the right word for us right now. What are we perceiving in our minds? That is the question. I know when my wife was speaking, I had a reflection over my different, you know, explores, and I said, oh, so I haven't even started. Now I need to start. Hallelujah. God bless you. God bless you, Pastor Soy, for the word. We thank God for that. And it's a challenge, and I'm going to live up to it because I have learned something new. Amen. Amen. And so we want also to also imagine something in our minds towards the ministry. It's time for us to give our offerings, our tithes and seed. Giving is special. Giving is godly. Giving is divine. You cannot separate God from giving. You can't talk of God and fail to talk about giving. He is the giver, number one. God minds us. He cares for us. You know, he is always, he has us in his thoughts. And because of that, we need to always remember that through giving, is, you know, you are walking in obedience. Amen. And so let's prepare something special and pray and begin to speak a word on that offering. For those who are online, you can give through 559-205-7443. Text the amount to that number or go to Cash App, $ Covenant Faith Family, and you'll be able to give. Amen. When you give, give, and God will bless. I'll have to give using my mobile. I have a covenant with my God. I'll not just give change if I have something more than change. Amen? So I'll have to use my mobile to give. You don't just give because that is what you have near you, you know, out of convenience, and say, oh, I have just $5 in my wallet. Let me throw it there. No. You know, give from your heart. And so that's why at times you see I remove my wallet and put it back, because I don't just want to throw in a coin because I have it with me. I'll have to use my mobile to do what the Holy Spirit is telling me. Amen. And so lift up your offering now and begin to speak a word. Lift up your mobile. If you're giving using your mobile, if it's a check, write it to Covenant of Faith Family. And you can use the envelope if you have the envelope there and write what you're giving towards. Father God, we thank you for all that you have done for us. We cannot give to you carelessly, because this is a sign of love towards what God you are doing even around us, oh Lord. We thank you because, God, Lord, by giving, we connect in a special way to the things of the kingdom of God. And I pray, Lord, tonight that whoever God has purposed in her heart or in his heart to give, let your blessings, the windows of blessings, begin to open upon their lives in the name of Jesus. We cannot claim that we are not able to give. We do not have what to give because we do not give. But if we begin to separate the seed from the bread, for your word says you give the seed to the eater and the bread, the seed to the sower and the bread to the eater. I pray that, God, that we shall be careful to separate the seed for sowing from the bread which we are supposed to eat.
I pray that, Lord, that as we have been taught to renew our minds, that our minds shall be renewed in everything, in every area of our lives, O God. I speak a blessing upon every family, that they are stretching their hands, and Lord, we receive, Lord, with joy and gladness, because God, it is for your work, O Lord. It is for the kingdom's work, O God. Receive all the honor and all the glory. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Amen. Let's have the basket go around. The basket is right here. Let's have it go around, and God will bless us, even as I bring back our senior pastor to bless us and release us. Amen.
Back to you, good mayor, pressed down, shaking together, running over, give, and it shall come back to you. When you give to the Lord, oh, give, and it shall come back to you. Good mayor, pressed down, shaking together, running over, give, and it shall come back to you. When you give to the Lord. Father, Lord, we thank you, Lord, tonight. We give you praise for the grace to give upon your holy mountain. We ask the Lord that you accept this offering as a token of our love, and let the heavens be open upon us in the name of Jesus. Thank you, everlasting Father, for in Jesus' mighty name we have given. Amen, amen, and amen. God bless you all for everyone giving. The Lord will continue to enrich you in the name of Jesus. Just to let us know, our DDC is just how many days away? 10 days. It's coming up next week. Next week, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. And it shall be a very powerful time in God.